Today we're moving to a different, whole different kind of realm for the creation evolution topic. So yesterday we were really looking at evolution in particular, but today we're really diving into the Bible, and I'm really excited about this. It's an amazing topic to be looking at. I'm sure you're probably aware, for those of you who follow Adventist news, that in July 2015, people from around the globe congregated at the General Conference to make a number of very major decisions. And I think it was one of the General Conference sessions which really gripped the imagination of the whole world because of the topics that they were talking about. I guess it's a bit like the American elections at the moment, some of the things which are happening there. But of course, for us, it was the General Conference. And one of the topics that they discussed, or one of the agenda items, if I could be more specific, was our fundamental belief in creation. So there was seen a need to rework our fundamental belief in creation, and that was put on the agenda. And in particular, the fundamental belief was clarified or expanded, shall I say, slightly, to explicitly state that as a worldwide church, we believe that God created this world, what's in this world, in six literal days, in one week, and of course the Sabbath at the end. So they put that forward to, went around the world to a number of the theological committees and things like that. And then they put it to the vote. And so roughly about 2,000 delegates voted on this topic. Do we as a Seventh-day Adventist church believe in a literal six-day creation? And look, it passed with a overwhelming majority. And then they went on to other topics of interest as well to the world church. But I guess the question for you and for me this morning is this. Do you believe that 2,000 people in San Diego can simply put up their hands and then tell us what we believe? Is that how it works? You know, are we forced to believe simply what the General Conference tells us? And I'm sure what you'd be saying in your mind is, no, I don't have other people telling me what to believe. We're not a Catholic church in terms of, you know, we don't have an encyclical that comes down from on high that tells us what we believe and what we do. And so I guess what I want to work through with you this morning is this, is to say, this is not just something that a decision is made by a committee that we then follow through. No. What are the reasons why we can believe in 6 days? Can we believe in it, that God created in 6 days? And I'm going to share with you 7 reasons. I think it's a good number. 7 powerful reasons why you can believe in 6 literal days. So come with me. We'll cover a whole lot of different topics, and I think you'll find it really fascinating as we go along. One of the things I said yesterday was this, though, that often with creation and evolution, we start off with the evidence. We start off with the data. We start off with the DNA. We start off with the mitochondria. And that's what I did as well yesterday as well. We start off with, you know, anatomical similarities and geological phenomenon. We look at radiometric dating, all of that kind of stuff. And to be honest with you, I believe that there's times where we actually start in the wrong place. I believe we actually need to start with the very nature of God himself, because that is what it's all about, who God is and what he is like. And so that brings me to my first reason for believing in 6 literal days, and that is that God is all-powerful and can perform supernatural miracles. God is all-powerful and can perform supernatural miracles. Do you believe that, church? Yes, we believe it. And this is so, so important. Now, I put a picture of two snow leopards up there, looking very friendly. And a beautiful picture. I remember presenting some of these ideas to the university students down in Sydney. And they said to me, Sven, why did you put snow leopards on that point? Why did you do that? What's the connection between God being all-powerful and performing supernatural miracles in the snow leopards? It's simply this. You know, I want to ask you, do you believe, and I challenge you with this question, do you believe that if God wanted to, he could simply speak and there would be two snow leopards up here on the stage this morning? Could he do that?
Yes, he could.
He can, yes. And that's a very, very important point. Yes, it does. God can perform supernatural miracles. And so what this is saying to you is that God performing creation in 6 days is not only logical possibility, it's not only theologically possible, it can actually happen. Because the God we serve is able to do this. And this is not just kind of faith cop-outs that we might have. This is actually deeply rooted in the Bible and indeed in logic itself. And so I want to put up on the screen a very big word, ontological argument. I'm not saying that you have to memorize this one. It's a very fascinating concept in Christian philosophy and philosophy in general, but ontological argument. Let me show you what the ontological argument shows for us. And it's not that complicated, to be honest with you. But I want you to imagine the qualities of the greatest possible being, the greatest possible being in the universe. What are the qualities? And of course, I know who you're thinking of, but let me just run through those qualities with you. Number one, one of the most important qualities of the greatest possible being is that he is all-powerful. And you see this in the Bible. Ah, Lord God, it says in Jeremiah, it is you who have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and by your outstretched arm. Nothing is too hard for you. Amen? Nothing is too hard for you. God can do it. He can do what is possible through his power. Number two, God is all-knowing. Great is our Lord and abundant his power. His understanding is beyond measure. He understands everything about this universe. He understands the future as well. All-loving as well. God is love. You know, and that's a very important aspect of our understanding of creation. How God creates needs to match with his, not only his power, but also his love as well. Does that make sense? We need to be able to see God's love in creation as well. God is morally perfect as well. In Deuteronomy, it says, the rock, his work is perfect, for all his ways are justice. A God of faithfulness and without iniquity, just and upright is he. Very, very important. The way God does things is perfect. His work is morally perfect. And of course, there's the whole the challenge of problem of evil and pain and suffering, as Gary mentioned earlier this morning. But God himself is morally perfect. In him there is no darkness. The way he does things is perfect. And then it's also true that God is present everywhere. You know, God is present right here. Have you realized that? The creator of the universe. You know, and often we say, Lord, we're going to welcome the Holy Spirit into our midst. But the fact is, he's already here. We don't have to welcome him here. He's already here. We simply need to open up our hearts to him. And a very, very powerful concept. Do I not feel heaven and earth, declares the Lord? God is present everywhere. And then finally, this argument, the ontological argument, actually says that God actually exists as well. Very powerful. It's an amazing thing. God says, I am. I exist. I am the basis of all reality. And so you can see once I list out all of the qualities or the attributes or the ideas in this argument, it's very powerful. But there's two things or three things which are really powerful. God is powerful. God can perform supernatural miracles. God is also loving and morally perfect, which is so, so important for what we're talking about. How God creates is just important as the fact that he does create as well. Very, very powerful. And we'll come back to that as well. But the fact is this, that God has the power to perform supernatural miracles. Number two, reason number two, Genesis itself reinforces the idea that the days in Genesis 1 were literal 24-hour days. And this, you see this coming through in the text itself. There's multiple times where there's, it's just not days pulled out of a hat. No, there's things which point back to the fact that it's literal 24-hour days. First of all, the days are all always qualified, day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, day six, by the fact that there was evening and there was morning. There was evening and morning, and that gives us a time frame around which we can identify, lock in, what kind of time period are we talking about here? Are we talking about unspecified long periods of time, or are we actually talking about a literal day like the days that we experience? And that's always, the Bible always combines those evenings and mornings with literal days. The second thing is this, that the days are numbered. It's one day in the Hebrew, and then second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day. And whenever you have that number beside a day in the Bible, the majority of times, overwhelming majority of times, that is a literal day. It's referring to an actual day of a week. And then finally, in this on this point here, is that the Genesis account actually says this is the account, or this is the, in Hebrew, the toledot. So this is the account when the heavens and the earth were created. And this term, all the way through Genesis, is a term which refers to history. It's a term which refers to things which actually happen. You go through Genesis. This is the account of Noah. This is the account of Abraham. This is the account of Joseph, and so forth, all the way through. What it's referring to, what it's signifying, is that this is a historical account. It's not poetic or not mythical. The other thing, of course, is that when we go outside of Genesis, Genesis actually, the Bible actually confirms or points back to the fact that these were literal days. And of course, the biggest one for us as Adventists is the fourth commandment. Because right at the end of that fourth commandment, where God tells us, remember the Sabbath day, it says, for in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. God set a pattern, an example of using our work week as the way that He did the creation work as well and rested on the Sabbath day as well. And then finally, in Exodus 31, 17, there's a kind of summary. It says, the Sabbath is a sign forever between me and the people of Israel, that in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day He rested and was refreshed. Amazing. When you go into it, it's really, really powerful. But of course, there are people who say, well, no, hang on a minute. There's a possibility that Genesis is poetic or it's mythological. What about that? Well, the challenge here is that people who say that Genesis is poetic are simply making an assertion without actually going back and analyzing and saying, is the data, the biblical data, is the evidence there for it to be poetic or mythological? And notice these two scholars here, Stephen Boyd. He's done this statistical analysis of Genesis 1:1 all the way through to the end of the Sabbath in that account, showing that the material is not intended to be read as poetry. The evidence is simply not there. Or an extended poetic metaphor, but it's a literal account, a literal historical account. So when you actually dive into it, that's what you find. Not poetry, not a mythological account, but an actual literal historical account. And also another scholar, Walter Kaiser, has done the survey as well, and he's come up with the same reality. There's a lack of evidence for any mythological elements in these chapters. And the best way to describe this genre, this type of literature, is historical narrative prose. Historical narrative prose. That's what it's saying there. Now there's people who say, well, there's structures in Genesis. You know, you've got your day one, day two, day three, day four, day five, day six. You've got some numbers that come up. The number 7 keeps coming up. But I ask you this question: if I was to write an essay for my university studies, would there be a structure to it? Yes, it would be. There's the introduction, there's the problem, there's the main body, there's the conclusion. Just having a structure does not mean it's poetry. It does not mean it's poetry. And when you dive into it, what you find is that it's the better description, the more accurate description of Genesis is its historical account. It's historical narrative prose is what we're looking at here. And the amazing thing is there is a poetic account of creation in the Bible. Did you realize that? But it's not found in Genesis. It's found in Psalms. And what's Psalms full of? Songs, poetry. And that's what we find in the Bible. And I've just put them both up here for you to compare these two and notice the difference between them. You know, in Genesis 1, it's a factual account. It's prose. It's the lines just keep running on. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And God saw that the light was good. And God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning the first day. You know it so well. But compared Psalm 104 with that. Psalm 104 reads like this, the first five verses. "Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty, covering yourself with light as with a garment, stretching out the heavens like a tent. He lays the beams of his chambers on the waters. He makes the clouds his chariot. He rides on the wings of the wind. He makes his messengers winds. His ministers a flaming fire. He sets the earth on its foundation so it should never be moved." What you see here is clearly poetry. It's the songwriting of the Psalms. Very, very different from what you see in Genesis. Now, one of the things to note is in Hebrew, when you write poetry, it's different from English. The way that you understand that something's poetry in English is because of the meter and particularly the rhyming words at the end of the lines. So when you have a poem, you look for the end and you go, aha, that's poetry. That's poetry. In Hebrew, it's different. The way they write poetry is what they call parallelism, where you put one idea and then you sort of put another which is similar but slightly different, but they kind of match. And what you see on the second, the right-hand side is that kind of parallelism. For example, it says, the fourth last line, "He makes his messengers winds, his ministers a flaming fire." Both of those are talking about angels, it's talking about God's ministers, but they're the same idea, but slightly different. And that's the parallelism, putting sort of those concepts side by side. And you see this all the way through Psalm 104. But what you don't see is that same parallelism close together in Genesis 1. You just don't see it there at all. So when a person says that the Genesis 1 is poetry, they're simply making what we'd call an assertion. They're simply stating, this is what it is, but without actually going in and analyzing it, saying, is that what was being written? Now, Joseph shared with me some questions, and I certainly welcome those questions. And he shared with me a couple of questions, or three questions, one of which relates to this. And the question that's come from people here at camp is, what do you see as the implication of treating Genesis 1 as poetry, in particular for God as creator, the Sabbath observance, and a literal six-day creation? Very, very good questions. And I just want to take stop in this presentation to answer that. So what do I see as the implication of treating Genesis 1 as poetry? Well, the first question is, we must ask, is it actually poetry? Is it poetry? And if it is not, then we shouldn't treat it as poetry. Does that make sense? We shouldn't actually call something that it's not. But let's say, for example, it is poetry. Taking this line of reasoning, what are the implications for for God as creator. Well, certainly the concept of God, you find the concept of God in the Psalms. You find the concept of God all the way through. So certainly you can have God as creator, even in that kind of literature as well. What about Sabbath observance? Well, the Sabbath observance, that becomes more challenging because, of course, if it's poetry, it can mean a whole lot of different things. It can even mean that maybe the Sabbath is some kind of idealistic kind of idea where we live in God's rest and in Christ's righteousness and his peace. And certainly we do that as well. But the thing is this, is that just because there's a theological truth does not mean to say that we don't have a regular representation of that theological truth. Just because I'm saved and my sins are washed away in Jesus' righteousness doesn't mean to say that I shouldn't go ahead and be baptized. Just because I have his forgiveness all the time doesn't mean to say I can stay away from communion and the Lord's Supper as well. What about a literal six-day creation? I guess a similar comment there as well, but the reality is this, is it's very important to note that poetry does not mean that something is not factual. And this is actually true for all of these comments. Poetry can be talking about literal, factual concepts, even if it's poetic. So I could write a poem about the Anzacs, for example, but it doesn't mean to say that everything in that poem is simply symbolic or simply myth. So I think it's very, very important, but we have to go back to the original question, and that is Genesis 1 poetry? And I want to say to you, it is not. The other thing, of course, is that some people, it's kind of similar to that, say, isn't Genesis 1 to 2 just theology? It's nothing to do with science, it's nothing to do with history, it's just telling us something about theology. But Richard Davidson at Andrews University has made this very powerful statement here. He says, Genesis 1 to 2 does in fact present a profound theology. Very important. It tells us about God. It tells us about creation and humanity and the Sabbath, etc. But theology in Scripture is not opposed to history. You don't have to have one or the other. You can have both. To the contrary, biblical theology is always rooted in history. There's no criterion within the creation accounts of Genesis 1 to 2 that allows one to separate a cosmogony and cosmology, as some have claimed, in order to reject the details of a literal six-day creation while retaining the theological truth that the world depends on God. Let me give you a good example. I was the what they call the multi-faith officer over at Curtin University in Perth. It was funny because we had a bread distribution. It's a good way to connect with the community. And so we would get the free bread from the bakeries, and then we put a couple of tables up there with loaves piled up high, and the students would come along and get this free bread. Because some of the students, you know, can go for days without eating. And it's interesting, we heard that the lecturers got to a point where they say, oh, it's 10 minutes to the hour, well, I'll let you go now because the bread distribution has started, we want you to get your free bread. But of course, not only did the students come, we had some of the staff come along for the bread as well, so that was kind of cool. But of course, we served a whole lot of different bread, and one of the things we did share was multi-grain. So I said to the university, maybe you should change my name from being the multi-faith officer to being the multi-grain officer. I thought that might be more appropriate. But the thing is, as the multi-faith officer, my role was to work together with other faiths and other religions. And one of the things, I had a person from the library come, and she said to me, look, Sven, it'd be really amazing if you could get the Buddhist monk, Ajahn Brahm, to come down here on stage and to get the Anglican Archbishop, Roger Herft, to come as well and have a dialogue, to talk about their faiths. And I thought, hey, that's a great idea because it tends to draw a big crowd. And we did. We filled the biggest lecture theatre at Curtin University. And so we talked about what we would call it. Finally, we named it, What Would Jesus Say to Buddha? That was the title of the presentation, the dialogue. And I was standing there getting all prepared with my notes, and somebody walked in, and I could hear them on the way through. They said, "We have no idea what Jesus would say to Buddha. Why? What's that do? It's irrelevant kind of topic." But it was a very fun evening. But it's fascinating because in the evening, there was a young couple, a young Christian couple that I knew, and they actually asked the question. They said to the Archbishop, they said to the Archbishop, "What do you think about the resurrection of Jesus? What do you believe about the resurrection of Jesus?" And the Anglican Archbishop, "Well, it's a mystery. It's a mystery. We don't know what happens. You know, the Christ has risen, but that doesn't mean to say that the physical body of Jesus actually rose back to life." But you know, the challenge with that is it's basically what we'd call Gnostic, dualism. It's putting your theology here and your history over here and separating them. And the thing is, in the Bible, in the Hebrew thought, those two should be together. Does that make sense? That the physical body of Jesus rose back to life and Jesus Christ is now in heaven. It's not a mystery. We may not be able to explain how it happened, but it still did happen. And that's very important. And this is what Richard Davidson is saying here as well, is that there is no need to separate our theology in Genesis from our history and from what actually happened as well. They're together. They're grounded in history. And just a question on that one, which is very interesting as well, is I believe a young person wrote in, "If there's no problem for maintaining the themes of God as personal creator, Sabbath observance, and Imagio Dei, why do Seventh-day Adventists feel a need to be so adamant about their six-day creation, or the literal six-day creation week?" It's a good question, because of course you do find that theology in Genesis, Genesis 1. But the key, of course, here is this history? Is the theology closely tied up with our history? But there is a problem if you start to separate your theology from your history, and that comes back to the very nature of God. Because if God did not create this world in 6 days, if He did not create a perfect world where there was no sin and suffering and death, then we have a big slight on God's character. God has created in a way which used death, which is very, very important. It's not our sin which brought death into the world. It's God actually brought it in Himself. Of course, Sabbath observance can go out the window if you just take the theology out of the actual historical practice. The Imagio Dei is a very important, interesting thing as well, because in this point, there's a tendency for people to cherry pick, which is to pick the ones things they want. If it's poetic, if you can say it's just symbolism, then why would we say that we are definitely made in the image of God? Maybe that's symbolism as well. Maybe we have no reason to trust in our own intelligence as well. Of course, the other thing to mention here as well is when it says, why does Seventh-day Adventists feel the need to be so adamant about the literal six-day creation week? The point here is that Seventh-day Adventists, we are committed to truth. We are committed to objective, historical truth. We are not committed to what is scientific. Does that make sense? And that's not to denigrate science, but science is not always objectively, historically true, and not necessarily objectively true about the future either. And we'll come back to that in a moment as well. But what we are committed to is truth. We want to find what is the truth about what's happening here in creation. Going on from there, which is a very good point to segue into our next point. Just before we go on to that, there's some great people to refer to with regards to the historicity of Genesis 1. Professor James Barr at the Oxford University made this comment. He said, "As far as I know, there's no professor of Hebrew or Old Testament, any world-class university, does not believe that the writer of Genesis intended to convey to his reader the ideas that the creation took place in a series of 6 days, which were the same as the days of 24 hours we now experience." What he's saying is the person that wrote it down wanted to convey to us that it was written in 6 days. And that's what we want to find out. What did Moses actually want to teach us? Professor Gerhard von Rath said this: what is said here is intended to be held entirely true, entirely and exactly as it stands. Everything is said here is to be accepted exactly as it is written. Nothing is to be interpreted symbolically or metaphorically. The 7 days are unquestionably to be understood as actual days, as a unique, unrepeatable lapse period of time in the world as well. These are two really significant professors in the Old Testament. We could add more of them as well. But it's not only the Old Testament professors as well. It's also the scientists as well. Good old Isaac Newton. The guy that had the apple fall on his head or watched the apple. He says, methinks, it sounds a bit Shakespearean, doesn't it? Methinks one of the Ten Commandments given by God on Mount Sinai, pressed by so many of the prophets, observed by our Savior, his apostles and the first Christians, should not be grounded on fiction. What he's saying here is that the account in Genesis is not a fictional account. It's not a account which is symbolic or metaphorical or mythological. That's Isaac Newton on this topic. What about John Calvin, a great reformer? He said, it is too violent a cavil to contend that Moses distributes the work to which God performed at once into 6 days for the mere purpose of conveying instruction. Let us rather conclude that God himself took the space of 6 days for the purpose of accommodating his works to the capacity of men. He's saying this is so important that we understand that God actually did what he said. It's not just a teaching device or a thing that Moses is using to teach us about what God did. And then Martin Luther, good old Martin Luther, amazing reflection of what he said as well. When Moses writes that God created heaven and earth and whatever is in them in 6 days, then let this period continue to have been 6 days, and do not venture to devise any comment according to which 6 days were 1 day. The concept was there that they were trying to shrink it down into 1 day. But if you cannot understand how this could have been done in 6 days, then grant the Holy Spirit the honor of being more learned than you are. Isn't that amazing? Give God the right to be God. Give God the right to be able to say what he means and to be more learned and more intelligent and more wise than you are. Just be willing to humble yourself before this fact. And he goes on, for you are to deal with Scripture in such a way that you bear in mind that God himself says what is written. But since God is speaking, it's not fitting for you to wantonly turn his word in the direction you wish it to go. What he's saying is you shouldn't just take the Scripture and make it do what you want it to do. You need to allow God to say to you what is actually happening here. Really, really amazing. And that's Martin Luther, a person that agreed with us in terms of prophecy, righteousness by faith, and all of those as well. The third reason, so up to reason number three, almost halfway through. The third reason is this, that the deep time evolutionary science is not a defeater for recent supernatural creation. So evolutionary science does not defeat a recent supernatural creation. And you might be saying like, whoa, that's an incredible statement to make because, you know, it's such a powerful concept. But it's fascinating to note what two Christian philosophers have said about this. Notice what they say. Thus, the dialogue among Christians regarding different perspectives on the creation-evolution issue is not merely one about scientific fact. It's not just about scientific fact. It never has been, because beginning with Darwin, the creation-evolution controversy has significantly been a debate about the philosophy of science. Should theology directly interact and enter into the very fabric of science, or should science adopt methodological naturalism? And methodological naturalism is the foundation of theistic evolution. Now, Andrew asked me, he said, Sven, you need to explain what theistic evolution is so that we understand. Well, theistic evolution is basically the idea that we put evolution together with the idea that God exists. We try and marry the two of them. So we simply allow evolution to occur. So evolution is the way that biological life came to be. But we allow God to supervise over the process. So the mutations occur, and maybe God sort of gave a sort of slight kind of nudge along the way. He didn't actually intervene, but he kind of nudged it along the way. And we allow God to supervise that process. This is theistic evolution, in contrast to recent supernatural creation. But what these philosophers, these thinkers are saying is the issue is not about scientific fact. It's not about mitochondria. It's not about the anatomical similarities between chimpanzees and ourselves. It's about the philosophy underpinning it. So you have all of these scientific facts, this big box of information about geology and ice cores and genetics and biogeography. But underneath it is a philosophy, is assumptions which are being made. And that is where the real question lies. That is the real issue. Now, let me share with you, let me give you an example of what I mean. This is a metal detector, a gold detector. Wouldn't it be good to have one of those? And I went online, and you can get a very good one. A good metal detector will put you back $10,000. Isn't it amazing, just to find metal? $10,000 will get you a good gold detector like that. I went for a holiday last December. Went to Yumina Beach near Sydney. And I was just really looking forward to this family holiday. And so we'd set up our tent, went down to the beach. We're about sort of 20 meters away from the beach, maybe a little bit further than that. But it was really, really close to the beach. And got on my swimsuit, and it was just a lovely, lovely day. Put on the sunscreen and was down in the water. And on my wedding day, my wife gave me a wedding ring, which I guess as a pastor here in Australia is quite a useful thing. You know, it's great to be able to, if you're doing a Bible study, to just make it clear that you are married. But of course, as you notice, I don't have my wedding ring, and I'll tell you that story. Because as I was put on the sunscreen and I was lifting my daughter up out of the waves, and we're just having so much fun, and we turned around to go out, and I'm going like, there's something wrong. There's something wrong. What's wrong? I feel naked. And of course, you know, I've got my board shorts on and all that kind of stuff. And suddenly I realized I'd lost my wedding ring in the surf. It was just bubbling down into to the bottom of the sea. And of course, golden sand, gold, yellow gold ring. And I got out and I said to my wife, I've lost my ring. And we spent, you know, probably an hour and a half, 2 hours trying to find that wedding ring. We prayed about it. We asked God for it. We combed the beach. But, you know, once that ring is in the sand and in the surf, it's gone. It could be anywhere. It's so hard to see. It could be buried. It could be could have rolled out to the sea. Now, let's say, for example, there was a man that came along with one of these gold detectors. And for some reason, hypothetically, the wedding ring, instead of being washed out to sea, had come up to the beach and somehow been buried on the sand. And he came to me and he said to me, Sven, I've got this $10,000 gold detector made by Mine Labs, the very best gold detector in the world. Would you like me to help you find my ring? What would I have done? Immediately I've said, yes, help me find it. I would have even been willing to give it a go out in the surf. It wouldn't have worked, but would have been willing to give it a go. But, you know, so we could have combed the beach up and down and tried to find it. We might have found some other things, some coins, maybe some other lost rings or, you know, bottle tops or whatever. But let's say, for example, the next day I came down to the beach. And I this time, instead of losing my wedding ring, I happened to lose the lid of my wife Marilyn's favorite plastic Tupperware container. Yeah? So we're having our lunch, and we're making sandcastles, and I use the Tupperware lid as some kind of structural kind of device. We go away because I forgot about that. Kids come along, and they cover it all up. And the same man comes along to me and says, I've got this metal detector. I will help you. I'm here to help you find your plastic Tupperware lid. What would I have said? No. You've simply got the wrong instrument. Your metal detector, no matter how good it is, no matter if it's $100,000, would not be able to find my plastic lid. Does that make sense? And he could say, no, I know the value of this instrument. I know how good it is. I am going to find it. I'm going to find your plastic lid. He would have been searching all day, all night, and he would have never found that plastic lid. This is the issue with science that is committed to methodological naturalism. And this is the fact, is that methodological naturalism assumes that miracles did not occur, right? That is what it assumes. So by its very nature, science is unable to catch supernatural miracles. It's like having a net, and a very good net, which catches so many fish. And I go out with somebody and I say, look, we really want to catch fish. And I say, I'm pretty sure there's very tiny fish out there. And the person says to me, that's great. This is the best net I've ever got. I've always caught fish. And I say, no, but hang on a minute. There's small fish there which are smaller than your holes. And the person says to me, no, I know that this net can catch those fish. Well, the reality of it is that net wouldn't be able to catch those fish. And this is the problem with science that is committed to methodological naturalism. It simply cannot do it. So, and the fact is this, is that theistic evolutionists will say, we should be committed to science based on methodological naturalism. But the fact is this, as evangelical Christians, we are already committed to miracles occurring. We believe that Jesus rose from the dead. We believe that he turned water into wine. We believe that he was conceived supernaturally of the Holy Spirit. We believe that he healed people, rose people back to life. He could turn deaf people so that they could hear. And the fact is this, is that no matter how much people who are committed to science, methodological naturalism will say, is that we as a church believe that God can and could intervene right here and right now and perform a miracle. Is that true? He can. And that's the point, is that science, and that's not denigrating science. That's basically saying there's limits to what science can do. My car cannot fly to the moon, but it's still a very good machine, even though it's just a Honda Prelude. I'm simply recognizing that is what it can do. I'm simply recognizing that metal detectors can only detect metal. I'm simply recognizing that this net cannot catch small fish. And that's the same thing which is happening here, which is very important, because what we are saying when we're looking at creation is this, is that in 6 days, God performed a series of miracles to create life. And because of that, science that is committed to methodological naturalism cannot catch, cannot detect, cannot confirm that actually occurred. So, so important. It can give support to it, but it cannot actually do the work that we require it to do. A very famous Christian philosopher made this comment, very powerful. He said this, methodological naturalism, however, though widely accepted and indeed exalted, has little to be said for it. When examined coolly in the light of day, the arguments for it seem weak indeed. We should therefore reject it, taken in its generality, because we should join others in Dumian science, but we should also pursue our own Augustinian science as well. Those big words at the end. Dumian science is basically science where you don't include God. Augustinian science is Christian science. What he's saying is we may join people in doing science where we don't appeal to miracles and things like that, but there's a time where we need to say, yes, we are going to do Christian science. We can actually look at DNA. We can look at mitochondria. We can look at the human body and say, yes, I see design. And that is not discounting the scientific facts that we actually have. So to make this point, let me just share with you this illustration. Because scientists will say to us that we are 96% roughly genetically similar to chimpanzees. So they're kind of friendly creatures with a good laugh. And of course, that figure depends on how you actually calculate the similarity across the genome. But the fact is this, is that there's two possible explanations for the fact that we are similar genetically and anatomically to chimpanzees. Number one, there's a possibility that we had a common ancestor. There's that possibility. That's what evolutionists would say. There's the other possibility that we have a common designer, that the person who designed chimpanzees also designed us as well, in terms of genetics, in terms of anatomy, and all of those kind of things that we have in common. Now, the point is this, is that methodological naturalism, theistic evolution, forces us to choose that option. Basically, it says that's the only option you can choose. Now, do you remember me saying to you, you know, does it make sense for 2,000 people in San Diego to put up their hands and force us to believe a particular direction? Well, let me tell you this, that methodological naturalism forces us to make that choice. But the reality of it is that God can create us similar to chimpanzees. He can do it by doing a supernatural miracle, which science cannot detect, science cannot confirm, when it's limited, constrained to methodological naturalism. The other thing as well in science, it's very important to understand that underneath it is this philosophy as well. So I want to invite you to imagine that you're my geology research team. And I've come from back from Patagonia. So I've come back from the South America, and in one of the caves there, in the mountains in down in Chile and Argentina, I found this device here, and it's basically sand in the top, basically pouring down to sand in the bottom. And I say to you, as my research team, I say to you, I believe that this device actually is counting time. I believe that it's actually calculating time. And I say to you, I want to know how long has this time clock been running for. So you go away, you say, okay, our research manager is calling us to make this calculation to determine how long this this timepiece, this clock has been running for. And so you, using the most sensitive, accurate instrumentation that you have, start to make some measurements. So you start to make these measurements. First of all, you'd measure how much sand is in the top of that timepiece. You would measure what's the rate at which sand is pouring through the neck there. And finally, you'd also calculate how much sand is in the bottom there. But you might say, look, oh, that's not quite enough. We need a bit more information here. We need to understand a bit more. So you also work out how much sand is being added to this this hourglass, this timepiece, and also you calculate how much sand is being lost. So you come back to me and say, Sven, we've done it. We've used our most accurate instrumentation in the world to calculate this, and we've come up with all these measurements. And I say to you, that's great, but it's not what I asked for. I asked you to find how long this timepiece has been running for. That's what I wanted. And so you go away and you think for a minute and you say, we've got to do some more thinking here. We've got to use our brains. And what suddenly, bang, you go, I know what we'll do. We'll make some assumptions here. We'll make an assumption that at the beginning, there was 100% of the sand. All the sand was in the top. We'll assume that the rate is constant. We'll assume that there was nothing in the bottom to start off with. We'll also assume that nothing has been added in the process. And then we'll also assume that nothing has been lost. So you then go to your computer, your Unix computer, you start up MATLAB, and you put in all of this information, and bang, you come out with the answer. This clock has been running for 4.54 billion years. That's the calculations that you made. It's great. The numbers all work. The number you got out at the end is right, 4.54 billion years in terms of, you know, just hypothetically here. Where's the problem? The assumptions. Yes. And this is the key with methodological naturalism and science, which is committed to that philosophy of science, is because you're making all of those assumptions, and they may not be historically true. They may not be. And so your number works beautifully, your calculation works beautifully, but the issue is that you may have come up with the wrong date simply because you've assumed the wrong things to start off with. Does that make sense? This is so important to understand. And this will happen all the time when you have science constrained to methodological naturalism. When you have science which is committed to life without God, with life without God intervening and working miracles. The other thing as well, which is very important to note too, is that science is a provisional process. And this is true whether you're talking about science committed to methodological naturalism or to Christian science. And that is that it's an ongoing process. So Professor Richard Alley, who is a guy who studies the ice cores down in Antarctica and Greenland, he said, all scientific ideas are subject to revision. We can never be absolutely sure that the truth has been reached. We simply cannot make that. And so the question is this, why would we hang our whole theology and our whole eternity on something which could actually change? Professor Stephen Hawking, the guy in the wheelchair that talks with that computer-aided voice, has said this in his book, The Grand Design. The Big Bang Theory is just a scientific model. It's not necessarily historically true. So, so important. And so often when we read in the media, it's statements which are so absolute, so sure, absolutely certain, but the fact is science itself is an ongoing process. And that isn't saying nothing about science. It's just saying we're an ongoing journey with science. And of course, that reminds me of the saying, the person who marries the science of the age will be or can be a widower in the next. It's so important to understand the very nature of science compared to the very nature of other truth statements that we have. Reason number four, quickly running through what we talked about yesterday. Belief in evolution is self-refuting. It undermines itself. Let me give you an example. You might say, well, what did you mean? What did you mean when you said it's irrational to be an atheist and to believe in evolution as well? Well, let me give you an example. There's postmodern philosophers will hold that this statement is true. There is no absolute truth. Have you heard that? Yeah, we have. There is no absolute truth. What's the problem with this statement? It can't be true. It undermines itself. It fails by its very own standard. Does that make sense? It cannot be true by its own criteria. But there's another one as well. A statement can only be true if it can be verified by scientific evidence. This is a very typical statement. It's a statement that you'll hear from Richard Dawkins and people like that, people who are committed to what we call scientism. It seems very intellectual, very rational as well. But what's the problem with this one? It can't be verified himself. Yes, there is no scientific evidence for this statement. So once again, by its very own criteria, it fails. There can be statements which are true, which you can't verify scientifically. Does that make sense? It's so, so important. So let's come to the next one. This is kind of cool. I have an unreliable mind and have no reason to trust that any of my mind's conclusions are actually true. I have an unreliable mind and I have no reason to believe that any of my mind's conclusions are actually true. Where's the problem with this? Well, that's one of my own thoughts. That's one of my own conclusions. So once again, by its very own criteria, I can't trust that one either. It's an amazing self-refuting, self-defeating statement. Now we move on to the next one. My human body, which includes my brain, evolved through a process of genetic mutations and natural selection, naturalistically. Now you might say there's no obvious issue with that. But the thing is, of course, this statement actually ties in with statement number three, and they both, when combined together, they both fail each other. They both destroy each other. So as Darwin himself said, with the horrid thought, horrid doubt always arises whether the convictions of man's mind, which has been developed from the minds of lower animals, are of any value or at all trustworthy. Would anyone trust in the convictions of a monkey's mind if there are any convictions in such mind? He's saying, I don't know if we can trust human thinking. And of course, that combines with Alvin Plantinga, where he came up with this argument, the evolutionary argument against naturalism, shows that if someone accepts naturalistic evolution and sees that the probability of having reliable cognitive faculties is low, then that person has a defeater for their belief in naturalistic evolution. And to summarize that, basically, it's irrational to be an atheist and believe in evolution. Just like it's irrational for me to say to you, I have an unreliable mind and I have no confidence in any of my conclusions. It's irrational to state that, to believe that. Very, very powerful. And the same issue applies for theistic evolution when you actually dig into it as well. Reason number five, the last three reasons here. The amazing thing is this, is that when we talk about creation, we're not only talking about in the beginning, we're also talking about the end as well. Because at the end of the Bible, it says this, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away and the sea was no more." And I like to share with the people listening, imagine that God gave me a penthouse suite to watch the process of the new creation. So and you're invited as well. So we have this amazing balcony view with a hand railing. We sit there and we fold our arms and we're going to watch God creating. My question for you is this: how long will we be waiting there for? Millions and billions of years? No, the reality of it is that God can create the new heavens and the earth so much more quickly, so much more. It doesn't necessarily take millions and billions of years. And if that is true for the new creation at the end of time, where God can create a world where there's no pain, no suffering, no death, even in the animal kingdom as well, it is true that God can do it back in the beginning as well. Do you see my point? The original creation parallels the end of the new creation too. And Richard Davidson makes this point very clear. In the overall canonical flow of Scripture, in the flow of the Bible, because of the inextricable connection between protology, the beginning, and eschatology, without a literal beginning, there is no literal end. So important that we understand the full Bible. We read Genesis in the light of Revelation. We read Revelation in the light of Genesis. We take the scriptura tota, the total Bible. We don't just pick and choose our ideas from the Bible. Reason number six, the gift of prophecy also confirms the biblical teaching on creation as well. You know, God has given us some amazing gifts in His church. God has given us the Holy Spirit. And it says, especially desire the gifts of the Spirit, eagerly desire the gifts of the Spirit, especially prophecy. And in 1 Corinthians, it says, "The eye cannot say to the hand, 'I don't need you,' and the head cannot say to the feet, 'I don't need you.' On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indescribable." And then in 1 Thessalonians, "Do not despise prophecies, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good." If God wants to share a message with you, if God wants to reveal what He has done, then God speaks to us through prophets. And it's so important that we actually listen to people who have the prophetic ministry and are willing to actually say, yes, we're willing to humble ourselves to listen what God has shared. I want to share with you the comments by a person whose prophetic ministry spanned the 20th century. He was an American man, and he was a person that felt called to ministry. He never went to theological seminary. He simply studied the Bible. And it's amazing he got to the point where he thought, you know, my ministry would be so much more powerful if I was able to understand the books of Shakespeare, because of the literature, because of the connections between the King James language and Shakespeare. So he got down on his knees and he prayed, "God, I pray that even though I don't have the education that I need, I pray that you would give me the understanding." And then he went on to analyze and understand even Shakespeare itself. His name was A.W. Tozer, a person that the Protestant world has recognized had a prophetic ministry. Powerful, powerful writings that when you read them, they basically speak to your heart and you say, yes, I can hear the Holy Spirit speaking to me. This is what he said. "We have gotten accustomed to the blurred puffs of gray fog that pass for doctrine in modernistic churches and expect nothing better. But it is a cause for real alarm that the fog has begun of late to creep into many evangelical churches. From some previously unimpeachable sources are now coming vague statements consisting of a milky admixture of scripture, science, and human sentiment that is true to none of its ingredients because each one works to cancel the others out. It's using older English, but he's saying there's people in our churches who are trying to integrate scripture and naturalistic science and human sentiment in a way that they all cancel each other out. And he goes on to say, certain of our evangelical brethren appear to be laboring under the impression that they're advanced thinkers because they are rethinking evolution and reevaluating various Bible doctrines or even divine inspiration itself. But so far are they from being advanced thinkers that they are merely timid followers of modernism, 50 years behind the parade. People who say, yes, we are intellectual, we're advanced in our thinking, we are integrating evolution and the Bible. What A.W. Tozer, in prophetic words, is saying, these people are simply timid followers of ideas that have been going on for 50 years. And I think that's so important to actually understand and really say, is this the Holy Spirit speaking to me through the prophetic ministry of A.W. Tozer? And he goes on, little by little, evangelical Christians these days are being brainwashed. One evidence is that increasing numbers of them are becoming ashamed to be found unequivocally on the side of truth. They say they believe, but their beliefs have been so diluted as to be impossible of clear definition. You get people who, I don't know where I stand on certain issues, and this includes even creation itself. This is what A.W. Tozer said. But of course, he's not the only person who's had a prophetic ministry. Of course, in our church, we have the gift of prophetic ministry as well. And just listen to these words. Like the Sabbath, the week originated at creation and has been preserved and brought down to us through Bible history. God himself measured off the first week as a sample for the successive weeks to the close of time. Like every other, it consisted of seven literal days. 6 days were employed in the work of creation. Upon the seventh, God rested. And he then blessed this day and set it apart as a day of rest for men and women. God created man in his own image. There is no mystery. Reminds me of the Anglican Archbishop in Perth. There is no mystery. There is no ground for the supposition that man was evolved by slow degrees of development from the lower forms of animal or vegetable life. Such teaching lowers the great work of the Creator to the level of man's narrow earthly conceptions. Man is so intent upon excluding God that they degrade man. We are actually brought down by the theory of evolution, naturalistic evolution, and even theistic evolution, that they degrade man and women, men and women, defraud him of the dignity of his origin. The genealogy of our race is given by inspiration, traces back its origin not to a line of developing germs, mollusks, and quadrupeds, but to the great Creator. Though formed from the dust, Adam was the son of God. That's what she's saying. The Bible record, she goes on, is in harmony with itself and with the teaching of nature. Of the first day employed in the week of creation is given the record, the evening and the morning were the first day. And the same substance is said of each of the first 6 days of creation week. Each of these periods, inspiration declares to have been a day consisting of evening and morning, like every other day since that time. In regards to the work of creation itself, the divine testament is, he spoke and it was done. He commanded and stood fast. With him who could thus call into existence unnumbered worlds, how long a time would it be required for the evolution of the earth from chaos? Powerful, powerful words. And you might be sitting here this morning saying, she was a person with only a third grade education. A.W. Tozer was a person who never went to seminary. I want to draw your attention to two verses in the Bible, powerful verses in the Bible, where the Pharisees themselves said this of Jesus. The Jews therefore marveled, saying, how is it that Jesus has learning when he has never studied? He has never gone to school. He's never gone to our university. The fact is this, that God can speak to a person who has humbled themselves to be willing to listen to the Holy Spirit. And when God speaks, that is truth, beyond anything that human reasoning and understanding can have, especially when you discount what God has said and what he has done, what he can do as well. And it's not only Jesus as well. You come to the book of Acts. I love this this verse here. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, fishermen, They were astonished and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. Absolutely amazing. The more time that you spend with Jesus, the more you can understand truth for what it really is. You can understand what really, really happened, what God wants you to understand. You know, there's times in this world where God chooses people who are not the intellectuals, who are not the pinnacles in university and in terms of research. God chooses sometimes the humble people, the people with a third grade education, people who are willing to humble themselves, and he can speak powerfully through them. You know, God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being may boast in the presence of God. And then finally, our last reason to believe in literal six-day creation is this, that the Holy Spirit, who is present right here, right now, can speak to you personally and confirm in your heart that what the Bible says is true. And you read this in the book of 1 John. I'm writing these things to you about those who are trying to lead you astray. As for you, the anointing you have received from him remains in you, and you do not need anyone to teach you. But as his anointing teaches about all things, and as that anointing is real, not counterfeit, just as it has taught you, remain in him. It goes on, and the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is truth. And then finally, we accept the human testimony, but God's testimony is greater because the testimony of God, which he has given about his Son. This is God we're talking about. This is Jesus who created this world. And John Calvin himself made this comment. He said, let this point therefore stand. Note this point, that those whom the Holy Spirit has inwardly taught truly rest upon Scripture, and that Scripture indeed is self-authenticated. What he's saying is this, is that I can take a primary school girl, a girl who's only got a third grade education, and I can give her the Bible to read, and she can read it. And when the Holy Spirit confirms in her heart that what she is reading is true, she can be more confident in what she believes than a person with a PhD, with a research career, with 100 research papers behind them, with a mountain of evidence, because it's God himself who's speaking to her. Really, really powerful. So just to summarize for you, why do I believe in 6 days? Number one, God is all powerful and he can perform supernatural miracles. God can do a series of miracles over 6 days. It's possible. It's logically possible for God to do that. The second thing is the Bible confirms that creation occurred in 6 days. The third point is this. Deep time evolutionary science is not a defeater for the recent supernatural creation we find in the Bible. And then fourth, belief in evolution is self-defeating. Dig into that concept if you want to understand that more. Number five, the original creation is also paralleled by the new creation at the end of this world as well. Number five, the gift of prophecy confirms biblical creation. And number seven, the Holy Spirit himself can speak to you directly and give you that confirmation as well, which is more powerful than any evidence or data that we may have in the world. And I want to conclude, you know, the question at the beginning, in 6 days, did God create in 6 days? I want to present to you this afternoon that God, yes, God did, and there's powerful, powerful reasons to believe that is the case. Let's pray as we finish this afternoon. Father in heaven, I just want to thank you for this time that we've been able to share together. I want to thank you that you're a God who is intimately involved in all of our lives. You're not a deistic God where you just wound up the universe and you simply let this universe run its own course. Father, you're also not a God who simply supervises the process of evolution, who uses pain and suffering and death and the competition between the animal kingdom and life to be able to produce us. No, you're a God of love. You're a God of order. You're a God of perfection. And even though we chose to walk away from you, even though we chose not to trust you way back at the beginning, you have stepped into this world in the person of your only Son, Jesus, so that we could have the choice once again of eternal life. And the choice that stands before us is this: do we take you at your word? Do we humble ourselves before you? And are we willing to say, yes, you are our creator. You are able to work miracles. We will not trust in our own understanding. We will not lean on our own understanding, but we'll in all our ways acknowledge you. And Father, each and every one of us, we are looking forward to the day when you come back. We're looking forward to the day when you come back in all of your glory and you're able to transform this world where there is so much turmoil, so much pain and suffering, into a world where there's harmony and peace between the lion and the lamb, between the child and the serpent as well. And we want to pray for that day. We pray that you'd come back soon. But even as we look forward into the future of what you're going to do, Lord, I pray that we'd be able to trust you about what you have said about the past, that you would strengthen our faith. And just like I prayed yesterday, Lord, I pray that you'd pour out your Holy Spirit upon us as a conference, as individuals, and you might speak to us that we may have this faith which is beyond understanding, is my prayer. And I want to thank you that we can continue this journey. May, as we spend this afternoon reflecting on more of your goodness, as we praise and worship you this evening, Lord, I pray that we'd be able to connect with you, the all-powerful, mighty creator of this universe, but also our Savior, who's compassionate, loves us, and who wants to spend all of eternity with us, is our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.